So today I'm going to look at this Keithley 150B Microvolt Ammeter. This is an interesting piece of gear. I found this locally for a reasonable price. I've got really no idea about it. I know very little about it, in fact. Just from what I can tell from the controls on the front. I did quickly look at it when I did the mailbag showing this thing arriving. So it's got this big special connector on here, and it's got this simple cable. There's two terminals on the end of it. That's quite interesting. But it does 1,000 millivolts and microamperes all the way down. Keep going down to 0.3 microvolts or nanoamps. 0.3. So that's pretty impressive. And this is the bit which caught my eye, is the fact that it can do such low levels. Over here we've got input selections for volts, open and with an obviously 100k load, I think that means. And it's also got the amps range as well for amps mode. It's got some kind of filter. It's got zeroing. And it does have battery option, which is seemingly dead. So I don't know if the battery's even in it. I've got no idea. I don't know the history or anything like that. So it's likely sources does have an Zenon plug on it, but that is wobbling around. I think I need to open it up first and look at that before I do anything. So it's got a 1 volt output, obviously a scale voltage or something. It's set to 230 volt already. It also came with the original manual, which is brilliant. It's got a really good manual. And it's got the diagrams in it. So you've got the full power supply diagram there, which is really easy to read, although upside down. And then you got the big fold out as well for the actual circuit. So it's got brilliant information. That's really clear with diagrams. I don't know if there's anything this good on the internet. I haven't actually looked for an electronic manual. There could be one. There could be a good electronic manual already out there. If there is, then I won't worry about scanning it. But if there isn't one, I might scan this and make this available to people as well. Because it's hard getting a manual this quality. This is just really nice. Usually you get manuals, they're like a scan or a photocopy of the original and that sort of stuff. This is the original manual, which is beautiful. Now, the actual circuit diagrams on here, I looked at this before. The date on the circuit diagrams is the 30th, sorry, no, American dating. The numbers are back to front. 20th of the 3rd, 1967. And then it's got the final product release on the 20th of October, 1967. 55 years old. I bet it still works. So I wasn't going to bother recording this, but I thought I'd show it on camera anyway. This is why I opened this plug up, okay? Because I don't know what the history's like with this plug. No idea. So I noticed the wiring was moving around. And yep, sure enough, look at that. The cable clamp, which isn't. So the actual wiring looks okay. It's obviously American wiring because it's black for the active line or the phase or the hot, people want to call it. And then white for the neutral. So the actual wiring looks okay. The green one should be longer than the others. It isn't. But yeah, okay. I can live with that, really. But what I will need to do is do the gland up, because that's doing nothing right now, which is kind of dangerous. So I've taken the screws out. Let's do the big reveal, find out what's inside it. Nothing. Okay. I can hear something rattling around inside there. That's always interesting. These are curious. Big pot down there, nice switch, couple of transformers. There's a few caps in there. Brilliant. A few caps. Fred will be happy. Not many caps, it's not too bad actually. Oh, then again, now I've seen that board. Yeah, there's a few caps in there. that's going to take a while to recap that. Anyway, that's alright. Big transistors on the back there. 281535. Three of those. There's still be something floating around here. Sure there's something floating around. I thought I heard something move. Now I'm not hearing anything. How do you get this cover off? That's that one. That one, there we go. Bottom cover. There's a bit of debris in here. Those lovely resistors, 0.25% resistors, nice. So there's not a lot going on here, it's a few things. There's some transistors upside down in sockets, which is always interesting. Surprised they don't fall out. These capacitors are actually little holders, look, inside little holders. How's that tension detail? Instead of hanging off the PCB or hanging off the legs, they put them in holders. That's really surprising. Also got some carbon composite resistors, those may or may not be problematic. There's a spiral cap there, you might have to look at that. Got a whole bunch of prism resistors, some more down here, 0.25%. Got carbons around here, that may or may not be a problem. Seeing it's on the ranging circuitry, it could be a problem. If it was going to be important, it would be these resistors here it's using rather than these carbon composites, because these aren't exactly wonderful. I mean, they're only silver banded as well, so that's 10% rated. Well, there's nothing horrendous in there. So I thought I heard something moving around, but I can't see anything. Maybe it's nothing. Maybe it's my imagination. I just thought I heard something. It's usually worth checking. So I was trying to figure out where this little bit of debris are, in, you know, where it all came from. It's inside there, floating around. And it looks like old foam. And sure enough, inside the top casing here, we've got a bit of old foam which is stuck down. And I can see a bit just on top of this trimmer here, on this adjustment, stuck to it. So my guess is it had some foam in here to help hold the boards up vertical, so it takes the stress off. So it's actually supported in the foam. And then as that foam's degraded over time, it's just fallen apart. So I think it had a foam strip across these two. Or over there, maybe. It might have been over there, and this piece has fallen off and landed on this. I can see debris here and here. Yeah, so I think there's actually kind of maybe where it's supposed to be. I don't know, but anyway, it's definitely had foam in there, and that's what's happened. That foam doesn't last. It just degrades and just falls apart in the end. It turns to powder, really. So yeah, that's what that is. So I might have to clean that off as well, but hopefully it hasn't got inside the actual adjustment. But that's where there's little bits of dust everywhere because of that foam's just gone. So someone just asked a question inside my chat here, my live stream, because I'm currently live streaming this. Where's the battery? Because it's a good point, because it is supposed to have a battery in it. And there's a fuse holder on the back here, which is for the battery. Nice protection. It comes through to this block, and the block has got nothing on the other side of it. So I think the battery used to be in here somewhere, because it was connected to that block. That's what I think. I'm pretty sure that's the case. The battery used to go to this block. But yeah, where did it used to mount? Interesting. There's no signs of attachment over here. There's a bit of tape here. That's probably nothing. I mean, there's no signs of mounting under here. Oh, cool. I've heard about this. I'll show you this. Just inside this enclosure in the bottom panel here, there's this thing mounted on the side. And I was looking at this. What's this bunch of wire? It's not wire. This is silver solder. So what happened in the olden days, to make sure they use the same solder they used from the factory, they actually stuffed some inside the casing. So if you had to do any repairs, you had exactly the same solder as they used to keep it all the same, because they're looking at stuff which is very low levels, and it's, you know, it's precision equipment. So they want to make sure there's no discrepancy between the solder you use and the solder they use to make sure it's all the same. There's no, what's the word I'm looking for, thermal effects from junctions. Thermal junction effects. They've got some solder in here. So if you need to do repairs, they've given you the solder to do it, to make sure it matches what was already in there from the factory. That's really nice. I've heard of this happening, and it's the first time I've actually found it. Brilliant. So before I was sure I could hear something moving around inside it. I've heard it move once or twice, and then nothing else. Anyway, I could hear it again, and this just fell out. It's a little spring washer. Where's that from? So I've been looking around trying to find out where this little washer came from, and I think I found it. Just down there. So three screws, one missing. And they look about the right size, and these do have washers on. So that is likely where they came from. The question is, where's the screw? Well, hopefully that screw turns up. For now, I'm going to keep it in mind that it's missing a screw. And it could be in there somewhere, trapped in a wire. Which is never a good thing. I mean, if it's okay out the way, that's right. But it won't stay there if it is still inside it. Eventually it will fall out and potentially short something. I'm going to pull these cards and have a close look at these cards. And let's have a look at them. To see if we see any rework or anything like that. Before I power it up, let's try this one first. It does look like it will just pull out. Oh, I'll put it back in again. I was going to see if it worked first before I pull the cards out. Let's do that. I'm getting distracted. So I'm just checking the transformer to make sure it looks like it's kind of okay. And got some slightly dodgy connections here while I'm holding it. So when it's in the off state, I've still got a connection to the transformer here. And when it's on, it's still there. Ignore the jumping around, this is my connections. When I've got a battery, it disappears. And battery test disappears. So it looks like when you got this thing plugged in, even if it's turned off, it'll be sitting there charging the battery in the background. That's quite nice. Right, so what I'm going to do here is power it up first, see what happens. And then if it looks like it's kind of powered up, I'm not going to do any checking, apart from connecting this up to the PDVS2 mini here, and we'll see if it's actually working or not. Even if it does work, I'm going to do a few things to it, like replace capacitors and reseat the boards, that sort of stuff. And I did start taking this board here out, and I realised actually I should be putting that back in again, because I want to test it before I pull those out, in case there's problems with these boards and I want to actually make sure it's okay before then. But if there's a bad boardage connector, I want to know about before I take the boards out. Now, as soon as I apply power to this thing, it will have power going into the unit, because it's, as I showed, the transformer's connected up, so we need to watch out for that. Even though the switch is turned off, it could still do something. Alright, let's spin the camera around a bit so you can see over here, and we'll go from there. Right, let's power this up for the first time. I'm not going to ease into it, I'm just going to chuck the power on and see what happens. Ready for magic smoke? So it's drawing 800 milliwatts, which is fine in its standby state. It's also the charging circuitry. It's dropped very slightly, and it's still dropping. It's probably reforming some capacitors a little bit. Rather than risking blowing it up, let's just give it a chance to relax a bit, and then I'll do it again in a second. Okay, I've left it turn on again, and it's borderline. It might have dropped slightly more, but not much. Its power factor is currently 0.2, which is pretty appalling, really. Let's turn this thing on and see what happens. There's a fan in there somewhere. It sounded like a fan. Something was making a weird noise. Is it meant to do that? Is that the noise it makes right before it goes bang? Doing 4 watts. It does sound like a fan. But what? What the hell is that noise? That is weird. It sounds like a motor spinning up, and the current's going up at the same time. Well, that is really curious. As it sounds like it's ramping up, the current's also increasing, which isn't what you'd normally expect from a motor. Normally the current would go down as it ramps up. Not a fan. That's weird. I'll have to look at the diagrams to figure out what this is. So that noise has been identified now, with help from people in the chat and the live stream here, because it does sound like a motor running. It's not a fan, it's a mechanical chopper. If I'd actually read the manual, I would have known that probably, because it is actually listed in here and mentioned, and yeah, anyway, so it's actually just over here. So that little block right there, that's a mechanical chopper. Very interesting. I've never seen one before. I've heard of them. I knew they existed, but I've never actually seen one myself. And the current rises up gradually to 7.4 watts and then stops. So we'll do that now. And each time I'm using this, it's actually getting slightly better each time. The noise is getting better and better. So I think it's freeing up slightly too. So it's seeing a 7.4 watts now, it's what it's settled down to. And the meter is settling as well as everything's warming up. So, okay, I think we're ready to actually do a test on this and see if it works. Finally get there. Turn the PDVS2 mini on. So set to 1 volt, so the 100 millivolts, and nothing. Let's go down to a different scale. Still nothing. Okay, so it does appear to have problems. It doesn't appear to be taking an input or zeroing or anything like that. Okay, it's moving around. Look, that is going down. Is this working to some degree? Go back up the other way. Okay, it's working to some degree. So the zeroing is doing something. but it doesn't seem to be doing a lot. So now I've ran that right round, it's zeroing there. Let's try injecting voltage again. I don't know what I'm doing with this. I'm just trying to figure it out as I go. 100 millivolts again. Nothing. It's not seeing any input at all. That could be a cable problem though. Let's check for that. So the washer we found floating around, that is from the mechanical chopper assembly. So I'm actually wondering if maybe someone's had that apart, trying to diagnose the fault we're seeing with this. It's possible, but then why would you go straight to that if there's nothing else happening? Maybe, I don't know. It could just be vibration that made it fall out. It's possible. So I just pulled these two boards out, so I'm just going to clean the connections up on the edge, just the board edge connectors, and I'll reseat them back in again and see if that changed anything. And this one's got gold edge connectors on the board edge, and this one does not. So corrosion and oxidization is a quite likely scenario for these cards. Even gold plated ones like this will have problems with oxidization. They will still get it. I've had lots of time, especially on things like the HP5342A, those are quite prone to it actually. The gold edge connectors, but they still get oxidization. I've repaired some of those before just by cleaning the edge connectors up, and that's what was wrong with it. Just clean the edge connectors made it work. Let's clean these up and see if anything changes. So I've cleaned those connections up with my fiberglass brush when I carefully done them, and put some dioxide on the board edge before putting them into the sockets. And so it's got some dioxide going to the sockets as well. I've moved them around a little bit to try and rub on the sockets, so it's got connections between the boards and the sockets. So that should be good. Check the capacitors, nothing horrendously bad. There's a couple of axial caps over here which I think might be tantalums, I'm not sure. I might have to look at the parts list. They're measuring slightly high, one's about 2.1 ohms, one's 4.2 ohms or something like that. But the tantalum is not unusual, they usually be a bit higher anyway. The electrolytics I checked looked fine, none of those look like they've got problems, so there's nothing horrendously bad there going on. So we shall clip this back on here and we'll see if we can get any reaction out of this. See if anything's changed just by doing the board edge connections. Sometimes it does fix things. Let's give it a chance to warm up. Right, let's try this again, see if anything changes. Injecting 100 millivolts. 1 volt scale, still nothing. 200, 300, 500 millivolts going in, and nothing changing on here. Let's go down to 300, go to the next scale down, nothing changing. So it looks like it's still dead. Clean the board edge connectors, hasn't changed anything, which is a shame. I wasn't expecting it to. It does sometimes help things. In fact, it quite often helps things, but having a complete failure like this would be unusual for it to fix it. But you never know. We'll get the simple things first. So I was looking at the circuit diagram now, and according to some other information in the service manual here, there's a plus and minus 12 volt rail, which is apparent on the other diagram here, the main ball diagram. This is obviously power supply. And there's also a 5 volt rail as well, which is dependent on producing the other two rails. So this is obviously the main power supply transformer and everything in this section. And here we've got a minus 12 volt showing here. Minus 5 volt over here. There we go. Minus 5 volt here. Minus 13 volt there. So it does have voltages listed on here for various sections. It is a matter of just figuring out where everything is. You've got plus 12 volt there, minus 12 volt there. Maybe the 5 volts internal to this section. I don't think it goes off board. Can't see yet. I need to analyse this some more. But yeah, we'll look at this section first and we'll figure out what's going on. So I think I've found the connections for these test points over here. So pin 4 of this edge connector over here to pin 6 is negative rail. 11.6 there, and pin 19, which is here, it's giving us 12 volt rail. So that those two rails are there. Let's check for ripple on them. That looks fine. And check the other one. That looks fine as well. So there's nothing horrendous coming through there. Now I believe there's some other connections here I need to look at as well. Figure out what they are again, I've forgotten. So pin 2 and 3 should also have something on them. I don't know if it's a reference to the same voltage rail though. 5.8, 5.9, those look fine as well. I think there's still more though.